We're looking at an interesting message today. It's Genesis, in the beginning. The subject of today's message is the beginning of earth, the beginning of time, the beginning of life. We find this account in the first couple of chapters of the book, the biblical recordings found in Genesis. Science is trying to obtain facts and details about our beginning. Well, God has already recorded the most important facts that we need to know about this event. There's a lot of information that I'm going to be giving you today, so you really got to pay close attention to what's being said and allow these words to minister to you, to teach you, to inspire you, to encourage you. Okay, so science, when you think about science, science is trying to obtain facts and details about our beginning. Well, God has already recorded the most important facts that we need to know about this event. And it's recorded right there in the book of Genesis and a few other locations throughout the Bible. May our knowledge and faith be stirred today as we look into this galactic event. Let's get started. You may want to follow along with your handbook of life, the Bible. It's your handbook of life. I'll be reading from Genesis chapter 1 and a little bit into Genesis chapter 2. So let's get started. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God. And we have on big screen here, God. In the beginning, God. This verse begins with the declaration that our beginnings, humanity's beginnings, started with God. Thus we are introduced to God. It's all about Him. It's all about what God did in the beginning. A declarative statement that our beginning started with God, whose earthly name is Jesus, as defined in John 1, chapter 1, verse 1. And that reads, in the beginning was the Word. And we know the Word is Jesus, and we'll define that in a little bit for those that may wonder how I come by that. In the beginning was the Word, Jesus, and the Word Jesus was with God, and the Word Jesus was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him. Through Jesus. And without Him, nothing was made that was made. And the Word Jesus became flesh. There you go. There's the evidence. The Word. Okay? The Word Jesus became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. In these verses, the Word had to be a person in order to become flesh and to dwell among us. In this case, God in the body form of Jesus. God in the body form of Jesus came upon the earth, came to the earth. Now, confirming this are the angelic words spoken to Mary in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. And she will bring forth a son, and you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So, all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. So, Emmanuel, Jesus, is with us, God with us. But some may say that God and Jesus are only a faith. And the idea of him creating heaven and earth is nothing more than a belief or a hypothesis, not a fact. Now, the truth is that while science is in the hypothesis and theory stages, it will sometimes disagree with Bible fact. Understand that. While science is in the hypothesis and the theory stages, not fact stages, but theory and hypothesis stages, science will sometimes disagree with Bible fact. But whenever science moves into the fact stage, it is found to be in agreement with scriptures. So today we will look into the facts of our beginnings as told in the scriptures. Consider that as the invisible wind blows, you know of its factual existence by the effect upon the rustling leaves. You know the wind is real because you see the leaves wiggling, or you feel it on your face. So you know the wind. You can't see it, but you know it's true. You know it's real. In comparison, I would state that centuries of lives being radically changed by one's faith in God is but factual evidence of God's existence. Other evidence is the gobs of documented facts of healings that have taken place upon those expressing faith in the God who heals. The facts even show that the demonic possessed find their freedom after the name of Jesus is invoked. Even non-Christian historians throughout the ages admit to the real life existence of Jesus. And on you go with additional evidence of God's existence. So Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God, what did he do? He created the heavens and the earth. Think with me now. God, who lives and exists in eternity, outside of time and outside of space, he created time and space, and he created the universe and the earth and all that dwell upon it. Next in our reading, God is going to give us some of the details of his creation and the order. Now, this is important that we understand the order of which he created things. He's going to give us some of the detail. Not all the detail, but the highlight details. The science is still trying to explore and hopefully eventually come into agreement with the scripture when they move into the fact stage and not into the hypothesis and theory stages, of which science is in many of the cases dealing with the beginnings of the earth. Okay, and so God's going to give us the order of his creation, some of the highlights of it. Day one, let's start. Sanctuary lights off, just to set the mood here a little bit. Good thing it's light outside so I can see. I didn't bring my flashlight. God created the earth. It did not just happen one day, haphazardly. Important that we understand that. It didn't just, poof, oh, there's an earth. Wonderful. Or it somehow happened, you know. Circumstances caused it to happen. No, it happened when God created it. He put it together. Now, to create, according to the dictionary, is to cause to come into being as something unique that would not naturally happen, or that is not made by an ordinary process. It also means to come from one's own thought as a work of art. The dictionary goes on to say, to cause, to create is to cause to happen, arrange as by intention or design. So I submit to you that earth was God's intelligent design. And a photo of the earth in the darkness, the blackness. So this is the way the earth was in the beginning. It started out as a dark planet. Verse 2. The earth was without form. This is from the Genesis verse 2 of chapter 1. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. The eternal God created and shaped earth into a sphere, and our planet rested in total darkness, for there was no light yet to see. Earth was without the texture formation of mountains and valleys and seas. No mountains, no valleys, no seas yet. Only the darkness, you see. Only water flatly surrounded the dark, lifeless planet with no animals, no insects, no sea creatures, and no human beings. And yet God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, was present over the darkness of planet Earth. Now these next verses can be very difficult to comprehend without the rhema of God. Now rhema is the revealed knowledge of God. Listen carefully so as not to become lost in the explanation of these verses that are coming up. So we can turn the lights back on. I probably went in darkness on the camera, but that's all right. And or silhouette maybe, I don't know. We'll see. Also the photo of Earth in the blue. There we are. Now this is setting the stage for this next event that's going to happen in God's creation. So first of all, he created the earth, and it was without form, no mountains, no sea, and it was darkness. And then in verse 3, then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. The evening and the morning were the first day. It started out with darkness, so that's why it's evening, okay? So the evening and the morning were the first day. If I understand correctly, that's how the Jews still keep track of time. They go from sunset to sunset. And so they go back to this route. So, here we notice that God spoke. When God speaks, things happen. His words are authoritative, and they're powerful. He spoke, and light came on the scene. Light came on the scene, for there was only darkness upon the earth. God spoke, and light arrived on day one of creation. But now, let's just skip forward a few days, just briefly, and we'll come back to it in a little more detail later. But briefly, let's jump forward a few days in creation and look at a curiosity. See, light just came on the scene. So, but here we jump forward a few days. This was day one. We're going to jump forward a few days. And let's read Genesis 1:16. Then God made two great lights. The greater to rule the day, and the lesser to rule the night. So the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Evening and morning were the fourth day. The greater light is our sun, and the lesser light is our moon. These were made on the fourth day, not on the first day. So, what was the light that God spoke of on the first day? No sun, how do you have light? No moon, how do you have light? Of course, the moon reflects the sun. But so how do you have light without a sun? The Bible is able to explain itself. Here now is the Rhema, or the revealed knowledge of God's Word. Turn to John 8, verse 12 for the answer. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. Woo! Jesus made this statement. I submit to you that the light that came on the scene in verse 3, day 1, was the arrival of Jesus. Jesus came on the scene at the beginning of creation. Jesus would come and go during the creation process. He would come and do some work on the creation, and then he would leave, okay? To confirm this idea that Jesus was the light spoken of in Genesis 1:3, we look to the last book of the Bible in Revelation 21:23, speaking of the future New Jerusalem that will be on earth in the future after Christ returns, after the so-called rapture, after the second coming. Okay? The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb, Jesus, is its light. And of course, this event takes place even beyond that, when there's a new heaven and a new earth, okay? That's when it actually takes place, where there's no need for any sun, no need for any moon, because Jesus, the Lamb, is the light. We are talking about the glory of God, Jesus. The glory of God shines. We picture it. The glory of God shines. It radiates. It radiates so brightly that no sun nor moon is actually needed. Also, if you remember biblical Paul on his way to Damascus, he was going to go persecute some Christians, and all of a sudden he was actually blinded. How did he get blinded? The scriptures tell us by the brightness of Christ's glory that appeared before him. He met him on the road, and the glory of Jesus was so bright and brilliant that he became blind. He actually got scales over his eyes from the brilliance of that light. Now look at John 1:10. Jesus was in the world, and the world was made through him. So, Jesus was on the scene at the creation of the world. Jesus was the light that God spoke of on day one of earth's creation. But what about the darkness? What was that? Okay, we know there was darkness. What was that darkness? Let's look at Luke 10:18, and Jesus is speaking, and he says, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Satan was kicked out of heaven because of the sin of his pride, and he fell, as it were, to the surface of the earth. I submit to you that Satan was the darkness that was upon the face of the earth, for there is no light in Satan. He don't radiate. I don't radiate either. You know, if I go in a dark room, you don't see me either, so I don't radiate. So, in this case, only darkness surrounds the presence of Satan. There's no brilliance, no light, no glory in him. Satan was on earth before man was made, and he later used the body of a serpent to tempt Eve. We see that in Revelation 20, verse 2. He, the angel, is laid hold on the dragon. And this is talking about the end times. That old serpent, referring back to the beginning of time, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and they bound him for 1,000 years. Though this verse deals with Satan during the future millennial reign of Christ, it links Satan as the old serpent that had deceived Eve. So it places Satan way back to the beginning of time, to the beginning of our planet Earth. So let's read again Genesis 1, beginning with verse 3. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light, Jesus, that it was good. And God divided or separated the light, Jesus, from the darkness, Satan. God called the light day, or you could say good. He called the light good. And the darkness he called night. And we could equate darkness and night with evil. So the evening and the morning were the first day. With biblical rhema, these verses tell us that Jesus would come and go from earth during its creation process. When Jesus was present before the earth, his glory would shine light upon earth's surface. When Jesus would come each day to do work, each time to do work, his glory would shine upon earth's surface. And when Jesus left, darkness would continue. Since Satan has no light in him, only darkness surrounds him. Thus Satan, darkness, was upon the earth, having been expelled from heaven. But whenever Jesus the light would come to earth, darkness, Satan, was illuminated. Thus you have darkness, evening, and light, morning, as the first day at this point in creation. Now, going back to the picture of the earth in the blue circle, there we are. At this point in creation, when the light of Jesus was present, the earth would have looked only blue. So Jesus came on that day and the earth would look blue because there was not yet any hills or mountains nor continents. Only the water still covered the surface of the earth. The earth returned to blackness again. We won't show it, but the blackness to the darkness when Jesus' presence left that for that day. Now let's move forward. Day two, photo of the clouds. It takes a while to flip back and forth. It's not that quick and easy. It's not like right down. All right. Now back to Scripture. Give our sound person there a good workout. Genesis 1, verse 6. Then God said, let there be a firmament. Now, what is that firmament? It's our atmosphere. So let there be an atmosphere in the midst of the waters. And let it divide the waters from the waters. The waters above from the waters below. Let there be an atmosphere. Thus God made the firmament or the atmosphere and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters that were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. God called the firmament in verse 8, he called it heaven. So the evening and the morning were the second day. Now let's explain some of this after this next picture. Let's show that with the sky and seas. There we go. And the atmosphere is between water and the clouds and, you know, the upper atmosphere and stuff. Okay? That gives you an idea. Where before it was just the blue. And so God created this atmosphere and clouds and stuff. All right. We also, now the firmament here is our atmosphere. The dividing of the water was the formation of clouds in the sky from the water below. We also want to note here, without getting into the details, that there are multiple levels of heaven. Remember the verse that said, in verse 8 it said, God called the firmament heaven. So there are multiple levels of heaven. We don't have time to get into the details of this today. The first level of heaven is our atmosphere, which this verse is referencing. Thus the phrase of heaven on earth is correct. Heaven on earth is correct. It's also the first level of hell, our atmosphere. Thus both good and bad struggle on earth. In other words, you're walking around, when you walk around in our atmosphere, you walk through the atmosphere of heaven and hell. Level one for both. The second level, there's multiple levels of hell too. Okay? The second level of heaven is our space, or the universe, if you would. And we are told of a third heaven that Paul visited, where God's throne is at, according to 2 Corinthians 12:2. And you can look that up yourself. That's what that is telling us, of the third heaven. So there's level one is our atmosphere, and level two is our universe, and level three is where God's throne is. So these verses tell us that on day one, Jesus, the light of the world, arrived again, dispelling the darkness once again, and he created an atmosphere. Then he left again, leaving the planet to return to darkness the second day. Day three, photo of planet Earth. Okay, it's looking better, huh? Looking a little more normal to us. All right, show the photo of the hills and the mountains now. There we go. Woo! All right, scripture. Genesis 1, beginning with verse 9. Then God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place." On the third day, we're talking now. "And let the dry land appear." And it was so. And God called the dry land earth. And the gathering together of the waters he called seas, not oceans. He called them seas. And God saw that it was good. Verse 11. Then God said, "Let the earth bring forth grass, the herb that yields seed, and the fruit tree that yields fruit according to its kind, whose seed is in itself on the earth." And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass, the herb that yields seed according to its kind, and the tree that yields fruit, whose seed is in itself according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. So the evening and the morning were the third day. So here we see, not the sun that we know, not the sun, but the light, who is Jesus, arriving, dispelling the darkness. Then he creates the mountains, valleys, seas, grass, herbs, and trees. Afterwards, he left again on this third day, leaving darkness behind. 3 days. No sun yet. All right? There are some other things in these verses that we should take note of. See, the scripture is just loaded with information for us. If we'll study it out, if we'll look at it and contemplate it, pray and ask God to reveal his truth to us, you see. Okay. First, Jesus, who is God, did not plant a seed. If you notice that, he did not plant a seed. But rather he created the tree and the herb and so forth, and the grass that produced a seed. Verse 11. And let the earth bring forth grass and the herb that yields seed and the fruit tree that yields fruit whose seed is in itself. So you see the tree came first. In doing so, in creating this, the tree and the grass first, which produced the seed, God set in the law of reproduction. He set the law of reproduction into place so that it would be a continuous self-producing process. And he established that its seed would always produce what the plant, the parent plant was. The seed would always produce what the parent plant was according to its kind. So in other words, orange trees do not produce apple seeds. It just don't happen. They don't produce grape seeds. Orange trees don't. But only orange seeds after its kind come from an orange. Verse 10 also tells us that God called the water seas, as I pointed out, not oceans. That title was assigned by man. We have seas, we have oceans, but they were called seas. The big bodies of water were called seas, according to God. Okay, the photo of the seasons, then you can move it right to the photo of the stars. Spring, summer, fall, and winter. And then the photo of the stars. Let's look at these stars. Okay, and we'll turn that on. Yes, there we go. Ooh, we got some movement. All right. Then God said that, you can leave it on, let there be lights in the firmament. Now we're talking about day four now. Let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens. So Jesus comes on the scene. So let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens, the universe, to divide the day from the night. And let them be for signs and seasons and for days and years. I should underline days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heavens to give light on the earth. So that there can be light on the earth. And it was so. Then God made two great lights. The greater light, the sun, to rule the day. And the lesser light, the moon, to rule the night. He made the stars also. Verse 17. God set them in the firmament of the heavens. In other words, he set them in the universe to give light on the earth. See, so we see right there that the heavens, in this case, is the second level of heaven, the universe. So he set the God set them in the firmament of the heavens, the atmosphere of the heavens of the universe, to give light on the earth and to rule over the day and over the night. And to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. So the evening and the morning were the fourth day. So we notice the light of Jesus arrives, dispelling the darkness of Satan once again. But this time, when Jesus leaves on this fourth day, he leaves behind a solar system. On this fourth day, he leaves behind a solar system. Is your brain clicking? He leaves behind a solar system on this fourth day with a sun and moon and stars to give light. In his absence, when he leaves, there's going to be some light by night and there's going to be some light during the day. The night light won't be as bright, but it will be there. There will always be an amount of light. It was not until this fourth day that God created the sun, the moon, and the stars, the universe that surrounds the earth, that's around the earth, the whole universe around the earth, setting their rotations and courses and motions, he did. Thus, you could rightly say that the earth is 3 days older. 3 days older than the rest of the universe. Did you ever know that before? I didn't until studying these things out that it really dawned on me that the earth is 3 days older, 3 days older than the rest of the universe, 3 days older than the planets and the sun, the other planets and the sun and the stars, 3 days older than the rest of the universe, for God created the earth first. It is what the Bible, this is what the Bible is saying here. If you believe the word of God to be true, then you better believe it. He created the rotation of the earth to show us light and darkness. Think about this now. He created the rotation of the earth to show us light and darkness. Here's some more rhema, some more understanding. Every day this object lesson of light and day, every day this object lesson of light representing good and the darkness representing evil is before you. May we learn the realities of good and evil and choose good, even as it states in Philippians 4. 8. This is guidance for us. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good reports. This is how we're supposed to think, people. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Truth, honesty, purity, love, good report, and virtue. Praise. This is what we're supposed to be thinking on. That don't mean we're ignorant of what goes on around us, but this is what we should have better attitude, be happier people, because we're thinking on the positive. We're thinking on the good. We are encouraged in this life to choose good, not evil. The changing of day and night is to be a reminder of that reality. So as the day turns to night and the night turns to day, let it be a reminder of evil and good, and that we are challenged. These verses are challenging us to follow what is good, you see. Let the light of day remind you of good and the darkness of night remind you of bad, to help you remember to choose the good life, to make the right decisions in life, to stay out of the darkness of bad decisions, and to stay away from what you know is wrong. Now, on a different subject, some try to placate to the theory of millions and even billions of years of universal development and evolution by suggesting suggesting the possibility of a, quote, day age. I've heard that before, day age. Oh, it's a day age. It don't mean a literal 24-hour day. It's a day age of creation. And so some try to come alongside of science. It's only in the theory and hypothesis stages, and say, well, this Genesis is just a day age. It's not a 24-hour day like we're used to. But they forget or they neglect the phrase, quote, so the evening and the morning were the first day, the second day, the third day, and so on. These words mean what they say. Evening and morning represent a complete day cycle, not age cycle. It's a day cycle, not an age cycle. That is why this scripture declares this day cycle to be a sign in verse 14. Let's look at that again. Genesis 1:14. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens in the universe to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and seasons and for days and years. We're not talking day ages, people. These days of creation followed one another as we are used to. It's not a day age. And he said, let it be for a sign to you. It didn't change. It's the way it was. Day is a day, from evening to morning. So, on that fourth day is when God created time. You understand that? That fourth day is when God created time and seasons. Understand that time is something that was created. Time did not always exist. Time is a created thing. God created and established time and the seasons. For right now, there is a season of time. We're living in a season of time, when there is time. A season when both time and eternity coexist. There's an eternity out there, but there's also a time that God made. We use God's created sun, moon, and stars to mark our time and seasons. But we must understand that before the creation of time, only eternity existed. And in the future, when our world and our universe ends, and it will, time will also end, leaving only eternity to exist. We're living in the age of time, but time will end, and only eternity will continue. Eternity and time are coexisting right now. Only eternity before the creation of the earth. God created time, and time will end, and eternity will continue. Eternity continues over the whole spectrum. Think about this. Everything within earth, everything within the realm of time has a beginning and an end. Everything within the realm of time has a beginning of end, an end. You and I have a beginning and an end. The universe had a beginning, and it will have an end. The earth had its beginning, and will experience its end. God resides in eternity outside of his created time, but he acts within the realm of time. God from eternity acts or does things within the realm of time, so that even Jesus' presence on earth complies to the law of time. He was born, there was a beginning, and he died, he was killed. His body ceased. We know it was resurrected, and now he ascended back into heaven. So hear this example, and this says it in a nutshell again. God in eternity created time. Then Jesus entered time as a baby in a manger. He died and ascended back into eternity after his resurrection. And the same Jesus will someday step back into the era and the season of time, returning to earth to rule for a set time of 1,000 years, the millennial reign. But after that millennial reign ends, God will put an end to time, and only eternity will remain. And Christ's rule will be forever, ever, eternity. So God gave us time and day and night as signs that we may know there is a beginning and an end to all things on earth. Next, day 5, photo of the birds and the fish. The birds and the fish come next. Back to Genesis 1, verse 20. Then God said, let the waters abound with the abundance of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth, across the face of the firmament of the heavens, our atmosphere. Verse 21, so God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves with which the water abounded according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind, and God saw that it was good. Verse 22, and God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters in the sea, and let the birds multiply on the earth. So the evening and the morning were the fifth day. It wasn't until the fifth day that the void or the emptiness of earth ended. The lifelessness of earth ended on the fifth day. I suppose in a way you could say it ended on the third day when Jesus made living plants. But as far as the breath of life, breathing animals, is concerned, the void ended on this fifth day. God spoke into existence the birds and sea life. Okay, birds and sea life. not animals, birds and sea life on this fifth day. Sorry, evolutionists, but as recorded, the sea life and fowl, the birds, came into existence both on the same day. The birds and the fish came into existence on the same day cycle. Not day age, same day cycle. The birds did not evolve out of the water, nor from other animals. The theory of evolution is wrong. It is flawed. We will also note that both species reproduced according to their own kind as God intended. A fish produced a fish. A bird, and so on, according to their own kind. Day six, we're moving right along. The photo of the land animals, followed by a photo of the first man. There's the animals. And there's Adam himself with some of the animals. Okay, let's move now to Genesis 1, verse 24. Verse 24 of Genesis 1. Then God said in verse 24, let the earth bring forth the living creatures according to its kind. Listen carefully. Cattle. Now, this word cattle, if you study it out, we don't have time here to get into it. If you look into the original meaning of this term cattle, why say cattle? Why not say, dog or something? Cattle. This cattle actually is representative of animals. Okay? Living creatures according to its kind. So God, on the sixth day, creating animals and creeping things. There you go. The spiders. Okay? And the snakes and that. All right. Creeping things. And beast. Now this beast, if you look into this word, we're talking about the dinosaurs. This is where the dinosaurs come onto the scene. The dinosaurs, it's not talking about our nice little lion. The lion is our animal kingdom. But the beast that they're talking about here, and if you do the study, and I got a whole thing on that, and I've taught about that before, you discover that it's dinosaurs. So you have the cattle, which is the animals, and the creeping things, the spiders and that, and the dinosaurs of planet Earth on day six, each according to its kind, and it was so. And God made the beast, the dinosaurs of the earth, according to its kind, the cattle or the animals, according to its kind, and everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. The dinosaur was good. And then God said in verse 26, let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, the animals, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Distinct, one from another. Male, female. Verse 28. Then God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. This was what he told man to do. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed to you, it shall be for food. Also to every beast of the earth, to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth in which there is life. I have given every green herb of food for food, and it was so. Verse 31. Then God saw everything that he made, and indeed it was very good. He saw everything that he made from day one all the way up through to day six. And he saw that overall it was not just good. This time he says it was very good. It was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. So we have animals and man created on that same day. And then we hit verse 1 of chapter 2. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. God, now we'll explain it a little bit. God continued his creation upon the earth on this sixth day with the creation of the land animals and insects. It was on this same day that God decides to create someone in his image and likeness. God decides on that same day, made all these animals. Now he decides on this sixth day to make someone that is in his likeness and image. Mankind is what we're talking about. Mankind is unique and distinct from other created creatures in their ability and intellect. Here is a brief idea of the distinction. Here's the distinction. All the creatures that God had made were given instinct for survival. But mankind, God gave similar abilities and attributes that he himself has. God gave to mankind a will, the power of decision. See, we were given a will, the power of decision beyond instinct. He gave to man the ability to understand and increase their knowledge. He gave to man a limited ability to be creative. We can create music. We can create art. We can design things. So we have a limited ability, similar to God, to be able to be creative. God is creative. And so we have a limited amount of that creativity. We don't create universes and earths and that, but we can be creative. He gave us a limited ability to do that. It was also mankind that he gave the ability to have fellowship with and a personal relationship with. We are special to him. He loves us most above all his creation. He loves us most above all of his creation. Now, if you do not have a personal relationship with God, you can have it today. Just pray and invite him. Pray to God and invite him into your life and invite his involvement into your life. Just pray and enjoy his presence in your life. Now let's look at the last day, day 7. The earth is all created now. There's nothing more to create. And there's the picture. All right, back to Genesis 2, verse 2. Chapter 2, verse 2. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had done. And he, what did he do? He rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed that seventh day, and he sanctified it, meaning he separated it and defined it from the other days. Because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. Now think about it. In reality, God created the seven-day calendar. When you come right down to the nuts and bolts, God created the seven-day calendar. It was God who established a day of rest from normal labors. He knew that man needed to have time to rest mentally, emotionally, and physically. Our body and mind, it needs time for restoration. It's the way that God made us. He rested and enjoyed his creation. God did. He rested and enjoyed his creation. Are we better and more able than he is? If he stopped to smell the roses, so to speak, then we need to stop and enjoy our family, and our world that he gave to us. We also need to refresh our spiritual life, reflecting upon the word and spending time in worship and prayer. That's why we have church on Sundays, once a week, to not saying that you don't think about God or read the word or pray to him during the week. You should do those things. But on Sunday, you come together and spend a little extra effort and in refreshing and renewing our spiritual life. He wants us, God wants us to enjoy our life as a whole. Now, in contrast to this idea of what God wants, we read John 10:10 tells us that the thief, Satan, comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I, Jesus, am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Now, God created the earth and the universe. He created man, and he desires a relationship with mankind. He wants to be your God. He wants to bless you and advise you and help you in this life. But he leaves the decision up to you. Remember, he gave us the will. He gave us the power of decision. He wants us to make this choice. He's not going to force us. We aren't going to be robots in his kingdom. He leaves that decision up to you to invite him into your life. He handed out an invitation when he sent Jesus nearly 2,000 years ago. That invitation still stands. God is waiting for those who will accept his love and care. And I ask of you, will you accept that invitation today if you haven't done so already? Will you commit your life into his loving care? Let's just pause a moment. Let's all bow our heads here for a moment. And you on video watching this, you can just think about what I'm about to say. Let's bow our heads here. Now, if there's anyone here who wants to commit or recommit your life to Christ, you used to be a Christian and for whatever reason you got sidetracked and you want to get back on track with God. You know that he's real and you just want his blessing in your life. You want to enjoy the blessings of God. You want to enjoy fellowship with him once again. You want to have that communion with him. And then there are those who may never have received Jesus in the first place. This is the first time when you've really come to make that decision for yourself. And you say, I want to be a Christian. I want the blessings of God. I want to live a Christian life. I want to live with God in eternity forever and ever. I want to worship him and praise him. I want to submit and commit my life to serving him for the rest of my life. If that's you this morning, whether you're here in this church building or whether you're on the video, just with all eyes closed and that, just raise your hand and I'm going to pray a prayer of which I will be asking everyone to repeat. Just raise your hand and put it back down if you want to commit or recommit your life to Jesus this morning. I'll just pause for a moment. The power of decision is being made. Your decision is coming. 3, 2, 1. Okay, let's all pray this prayer together. People in here and people, you who are watching by video, let's pray this prayer together. Just repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I ask you for redemption. I ask you to forgive me of all sins, all wrongs, all mistakes in my life. I want to commit my life to serving you Father, save me. I give myself to you. And I worship you right now. I declare you as my God, my Savior, my redemption. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for new life in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you've prayed that prayer, you know, praying a prayer doesn't mean anything unless you meant it with your heart. If you were sincere in what it was that you prayed, you meant what you said, then you are truly a Christian. You have become a Christian. It's like starting a restart switch in your life. You got a new beginning. You get to start over in life, so to speak. You know, you may still face some of the issues in life, but you got someone to be there with you, someone to help you, someone to advise you. You got guidance in this book. And this is what I want to lead up to. There are some important things that you need to do as a Christian, as a believer. Some very important things. And that is, number one, have a talk with God every day. Talk with Him about things you're happy about. He don't mind hearing the things that you're not happy about. If you have questions for Him, ask Him. If He don't answer you today, He may show you at a later time, because maybe you're not ready for the answer yet. You see? But talk to Him about everything that you're happy about, you're sad about, your prayer concerns, things that bother you, everything. Talk to God about it. It's called prayer. That's what it is. Pray to God every day. Very important to have a successful Christian life. You need to pray. Number two, you need to attend church regularly and faithfully. Find a good church, one that teaches the Word, not just a church that goes through the rituals, but a church that teaches the Word of God, that searches out the Scriptures and will teach you something. Not pacify you. Find a church that will do that and get in there. Be faithful. Be helpful. Do what you can to support that church. And when you go to that church, you get fellowship from other Christians who can also be supportive towards you and give you that pat on the back when you need to. Pray with you when you need to. That's the whole idea of church. Plus, you get to hear the Word of God being explained at church. And in Bible studies and so forth. And so pray, get in into church, and then read this Bible, the success manual for a successful Christian life. This is your success manual. You want to learn how to be a successful Christian, how to succeed in your walk with Christ, then this is the answer. This is your answer book. This is your guidebook. And it's also your benefits book. There's benefits in here as a Christian. We had a message not too many weeks ago of some of the multitude of benefits. This is a benefits package, too, that tells us of our benefits as a Christian believer. And so to discover that, you got to get in it. You got to read it. Your success manual, your benefits package is all wrapped up into one. We're so blessed that God gave us something. He didn't just say, follow me, and that. He says, follow me, and here's the guidebook. Here it is. You can read it. You can pick it up anytime and get support, encouragement, help, guidance, direction for your life. You can grow and mature in me if you'll look at the instruction manual. And so those three things to be successful in your Christian walk. All right. Well, let's just close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I pray right now for each and every person that may have committed their heart and life to you, Father. I pray that you would reach out to that person, that you would become so real in their life, Lord. May their hunger and thirst for you multiply and increase, Father. May they have a deep desire for you. Lord, watch over and protect them. Protect all of us Christians, Lord. Protect us in our goings and our comings, Lord. Grant to us a great day today, Father, a blessed day, Lord, that you would encourage our steps in the way we should go, Father. Help us also to remember who we are in Christ, that we may shine your light within the community that we live, Father, wherever it is, whether we're walking in the stores or in the banks or the restaurants, wherever we are, may we remember who we are to reflect you in and through our lives and allow you to do so, Lord. And I thank you and praise you. Lord, in Jesus' name we ask, amen and amen.